Part of our relationship with you, and that is that the God of the universe, the Creator, is for us. Amen. Your word says that we can do anything through Christ who gives us strength. You more than anyone, Lord, know our hearts. You know our weaknesses, Lord. But your power is perfected in weakness. The same way Paul says that he'd rather be proud of his weakness or rejoice in his weakness so that your power may be perfected. We say the same thing, Lord. Let us always remember that it's not about what we can do or we can't do, Lord. It's what you can do, Lord. It's the fact that you are for us, Lord. Thank you, Father.
Fill my life.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one we could ever say. Worthy of every breath.
Thank you.
Jesus, I thank you for today. I thank you that in 2019, on a Sunday, in the DMV, there's a group of people who actually find it of value to come and hear your word preached. God, I pray that you would honor that by giving us eyes to see and ears to hear you. In Jesus' mighty name, we come against any spirit, any principality that would seek to blind us, that would seek to distract us. Holy Spirit, fill us afresh. We need you for this. Father, help me to be clear, concise, and most importantly, anointed, so that the words that I speak will be words of life, Lord, not just chatter. In Jesus' name, amen. So I have to say, when my wife and I had the desire to start a church, and when we felt called to start a church, the goal was 25. And so some of you guys are going to have to leave. You know me, baby. I do say that because I'm happy that there are a few more people here today. But it's not because, you know, we want this big house. Statistically, I won't see most of you guys next week. That's just how it goes, right? No big deal. Like, some of you guys are just visiting from other churches. But the reason it excites me is because the people who are here week in and week out, they've carved this church and what we're doing here part of their schedule. Right. So it's not it's important that they come as well, but it's part of their schedule already. They come to church kind of like they go to work. Right. But for you guys who showed up today and you don't typically go here, to me, that says that the Lord has you here for a specific reason today.
Amen.
And that excites me.
Yeah.
So I'm going to try and go very fast because I have a lot. So having said that. We have been going through Revelation. Today, I've got a title for our sermon, Revelation 2, 1 through 7, Ephesus, Leaders, Wolves, and Jesus. So let's go ahead and read Revelation 2, starting at verse 1. To the angel of the church in Ephesus, write, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands. You know what? Let me do this first, just because we're kind of in the middle of a sermon. Let me kind of give everybody the context. So Revelation is a letter written by John, but it is actually the revelation of Jesus Christ. So where you have every single book is written, Paul to the Ephesians or Paul to the Romans, or John is writing to a group of believers. This letter in particular is a revelation of Jesus Christ to seven particular churches. So last week we did a lot of foundation. If this talk is decent for you and you want more information, go back to the other ones. Somebody will give you a link to the YouTube channel and we will have 24 subscribers.
I think we're at like 26 subscribers.
Come on, okay. 27.
I've been telling people.
Let's go. So this is the first letter or the letter to the first church. So this is Jesus revealing something to us. So he says, to the angel of the church in Ephesus, write, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand, the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands, says this, I know your deeds and your toil and your perseverance, and that you cannot tolerate evil men, and you put to the test those who call themselves apostles, and they are not, and you found them to be false. And you have perseverance and have endured for my name's sake and have not grown weary. But I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Therefore, remember from where you have fallen and repent and do the deeds you did at first. Or else I am coming to you and I will remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. Yet this do you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will grant to eat the tree of life, which is the paradise, which is in the paradise of God. So every single letter that we get to each church is going to have the same structure. So you're going to have four major parts for each single letter. So first is going to be a statement of authority from Jesus. Now, each statement of authority, you're going to see. Do you have that up there? I don't know if you do. It's okay. Leave it. So every statement of authority, if you guys remember, when we read this here, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands. Does anybody remember where that's from? The chapter before, right? It's a picture that Jesus gives of himself in Revelation 1, 12 through 16. He gives this almost terrifying picture of him where he has white hair. He's got flames in his eyes. His skin is glowing like coming from a furnace. And he's got a huge sword coming out of his mouth. Well, as we go through these seven different letters to seven different churches, he's going to draw back from the picture that we see of him in Revelation 1. And so in this one, we see that this statement of authority is that he is the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and the one who walks among the seven golden lampstands. Next, he's going to give an assessment of each church. How are they doing? The assessment of this church is actually twofold. One, he says, you guys are doing a good job because you're pointing out false teachers. And on the other hand, I have something against you. You've lost your first love. Then he gives a counsel to each and every city. This one, the counsel is to remember from where you have fallen and repent and do the deeds that you did at first. And then every single letter to every single church ends with a promise from the Holy Spirit. And the promise from the Holy Spirit here is, to him who overcomes, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. So I want to break this down, and I want to start with Revelation 2, verse 1. The one who holds seven stars in his right hand. Here's what's so interesting. The picture that we get in Revelation 1 of Jesus coming back and he's walking among these lampstands is actually explained in Revelations 1:20. Now, before I get to that, let me just say this. Last week we talked about lampstands, and it's just really hard. So many people, and we haven't gotten to, like, you guys are coming right in.
They're all on YouTube.
Yeah, they're all on YouTube. So I'm gonna try and go very quickly. And if you don't understand, so I'm gonna ask somebody. But I just can't go through all of Revelation 1 again. But so as God is revealing himself throughout Revelation, throughout the first chapter, one of the things that he reveals the Holy Spirit as is a Holy Spirit that shows himself as seven different spirits. And what we find out is that is a symbolism to something called a lampstand that's actually present in the holy place of God. I don't have a whole lot of time to get to it, but essentially, I want to do it. I don't want to take your time. So the Holy Spirit is revealed as a lampstand. If you don't believe me, ask me. I'll tell you later. But when Jesus reveals himself as coming with this power, he's actually among seven other lampstands. And we find out in Revelations 1:20, you can go into it. Go back. Thought you had it. Revelations 1:20, we find out that these seven lampstands are actually pictures of these seven churches. Now, here's why this is important. Because as Jesus is coming back, we actually find that he is there walking among the churches. Here's why this is important. Understand something. That as we sit here and we congregate, as they congregate up the street and down the street and all over this country on Sundays as a church, understand that we are not doing this apart from Christ. In the midst of it is Jesus. The big point of Revelation is all about wartime. Revelation is a picture of the enemy of this world and the savior of this world destroying him. And in the midst of all of this war, this good and evil, all of this, Jesus is coming, he's conquering. But when we first find Jesus, we find him walking among the churches. But I don't want to point that out because I talked about that a lot. What I want to point to you out here is to the angel of the church in Ephesus. Because when we read in Revelation 1:20, we actually find out that the seven lampstands are the churches, and he calls the seven stars the angels. Sorry, I'm contemplating whether to drink or not. Here's why this is important. Because what's terrifying to me, and I'll explain later, is Jesus actually starts not to the church. He says to the angel. So while he's addressing the church, he starts off saying to the angel. Now, here's the thing about angels. What does everybody know an angel is?
Messenger.
What?
Messenger.
So here's the debate. Remember I told you guys. Some things in Revelations are up for debate because it's symbolism and you can decide, right? So I'll tell you right now, there's a debate on this. Some people think that there are angels that are over churches that are in charge of the churches. Some people think that angels actually is just a messenger of God, which is just a human person. For example, Jesus calls him in Matthew 11, Jesus calls John the Baptist an angel sent from God. So the Greek for angel is just messenger. So it's just a messenger. We've grown, and as Roman and Greek art has kind of made every angel angelic being as opposed to just a messenger. So here's why I think it's a human. You can debate, it's fine. One, there is no reason in my mind that Jesus would actually write a letter to an angel. What we see in scripture is Jesus give angel commands and then they come. And he doesn't send a human to write a letter to an angel. So that's why I don't think it's, and that's number one. Number two, and this is the most important thing. Nowhere in scripture does it say that the angels are the responsibility for leading the church. Nowhere. It actually puts it on leaders. So when Paul writes to the angel of the church in Ephesus, I believe Paul is talking to the leader of the church in Ephesus. And I think the biggest reason that we're tempted to think angel instead of leader, it really is because we have too high a view of angels and too low a view of ourselves. Because in Hebrews 1:14, it actually says that when talking about angels, are they not all ministering spirits sent to render service for the sake of those who will inherit salvation? Mm-hmm. Anybody ever been around somebody and they prayed and they asked God to send an angel and maybe it freaked you out? Well, biblically, that's right along in scripture. Most of us would love to go to the church that's led by the angel. But God has set it up that there are churches who are led by men and women. The advancement of the kingdom of God on earth is not up to angels. It's up to the church. And God calls leaders to lead his people. So when you see angel, think leader, think person. I won't get into the implications of that. Some people think it's apostles. Some people think it's just leaders. I'll just say this. It's men. Mankind, men and women. But here's what we should get from it. John the Baptist is called an angel. Why? Because he's a messenger of God. And here's the most important thing that you get from whether leader, whether person, whether angel. The point is, a messenger comes with a message from someone else. The most important question that you should have of every single leader that you have is not whether they are a good speaker, not whether they are entertaining, not whether they are even whether they come from some great university. The number one question that you should have to every single leader that you listen to scripture being preached from is, who sent you? It's the number one question, because there are many skilled leaders, many wise, many who love Jesus, many who know the scriptures back and forth, and they make a great point on a resume, but none of those things make a man called. And I would submit to you, without going too much into it, that is part of the problem in North America. Is that we think that a leader is someone who is able to lead, who has the ability, but we don't question their calling. And anointing doesn't come with ability, it comes with calling. Amen. The call of Christ is what qualifies someone to lead. See, when you look at Paul, just really quickly. So Paul was somebody, when every time he wrote a letter, and go through, look at all the letters that Paul wrote. You'll see in the first three verses, it'll say, Paul, an apostle called by God. Paul, an apostle called by Christ. Paul, an apostle. And in Galatians, it says this. It says, Paul, an apostle, not sent from men, nor through the agency of man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead. Even when Paul is discipling someone, Timothy, who's a leader of the church, look what he says to Timothy. He says, this command I entrust to you, Timothy, my son, in accordance with the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you fight the good fight. He doesn't say, Timothy, remember, you a bad boy. You can preach the mess out that Bible. He doesn't say that. He says, remember, God spoke to you. He called you. And on the basis of that fight, because I promise you, every sermon, and I'll tell you from here, some of y'all have been here long enough to know, every sermon from here is not going to be hidden. So it's not the sermon, It's not how funny I am. I've proved to you guys over the last couple of weeks, I'm not very funny. It's not going to be how well I put the scriptures together. I pray God and ask him for those things. But the question is, am I called to be here? See, the crazy thing about Paul is, Paul was a Pharisee. And we get this negative view of Pharisees, thinking that every Pharisee is evil, but a lot of Pharisees got saved. And what a Pharisee was he was a teacher and he was a leader of Old Testament believers, which means he knew the Old Testament front and back. He understood it well, and he was taught by the best. And Paul never mentions it when he's giving you his authority for why he's reading or writing this letter to you. The only time he brings it up when he's making the point of pride. But Paul, when he says, I need to prove to you that I'm qualified, he always talks about his calling. Every single time. For a new leader, I promise you, this is required. Because there's people in here now who are thinking about being a leader, or you have a desire to have some type of position in leading when it comes to ministry. The number one question to you is, forget how good you are. Are you called to do it? So I say all that. And I'll just let you guys know, like, so this is just because I haven't had a conversation with all of you, but I'll tell you guys how we know we're called. Actually, I won't do that. All right, I'll do it. Here's why. I just want you guys to know that, like, even as we're starting this, and it feels awkward to say, but I just want to be honest with you guys. Like, y'all, this is not like a dope career move. Y'all know that, right?
Nope.
Like, this is not like my wife and I, we don't sit at home and we're like, man, like, oh man, we just have this desire to build this church. That's not how it was at all. We're here because it was prophesied. But when I had completely left the thought of ministry, and I just meant, like, if you get on my background, I've been in ministry for 14 some odd years, and most of it has been just evangelism stuff. I never wanted to have anything to do with the church because I felt like I could have more reach just telling people about Jesus rather than leading the church. Because when you're a pastor, people don't listen to you. But when I had no desire to start a church, Darcy and I remember we went up to prayer for just prayer for our marriage, and it was prophesied that we would lead a generation of young people into a Jesus culture. Twice for me and once for her, that we would be a father and a mother over the next generation. That my wife would have a ministry into the darkness. When I wanted nothing to do with church, it was prophesied over me that I would be a shepherd. So I say all that so that you would know that we're called, but I also want you to know that to be a leader, that calling comes with soberness. What's terrifying to me as a leader of the church is that Jesus is sending this letter to a leader. He's sending it singular to one. Why? Because leaders carry the responsibility of leading. And this is the thing that keeps me up. Praying for you guys. This is the thing that stresses me out when some of you guys make some crazy decisions. In Hebrews 13:17, it says this. It says, obey. Is it there? That's fine. Hebrews 13:17. That's easy. It's easy to be called if that's what you're in it for. Can I just say that? Like, a lot of people, they want people to obey them and submit to them. It's a lot of people that are in the pulpit because they need people to accept them. And this is why when I felt called, the Lord shut every single door. Wow. And I'm thankful for it. You know why? Because I don't need y'all to accept me. That's not why I'm here.
Yeah.
I don't need y'all to tell me it's a good sermon. That's not why I'm here. I'm here simply because he called me.
Yep.
Here's what freaks me out, because the rest of the verse says this. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they keep watch over your soul as those who will give an account. And I say this especially to the young men who are ambitious and they want this and that. You understand that every place that God gives somebody leadership role, he also gives them the responsibility. We were making decisions about how to surprise my wife, and the ladies in the group chat made the joke of, oh men.
What?
He said, and this is an old Christian joke. I'm not taking claim for it. But they said, oh these men, what would they do without us women? To which I responded, we'd still be in the garden. So. But Hebrews 13:17. But and I say that because if you know the story, Eve ate the apple first, or the fruit, whatever it was. But guess what? Adam was held responsible.
He's a leader.
You know why? He's a leader. So to the men who want
to
lead,
he tried to back out of it, didn't he?
He did. He did. Yeah, that's what he did. They said, God said, Adam, did you eat the apple? He said, it was that woman. That's what he said. He said, that woman that you gave me.
My rib.
Eve said it with the snake. But see, this is what leadership it should be. And I'm not saying this, please hear me, I'm not saying this to boast at how we're doing it here. Mm-hmm. Because when most of you, if you don't come back and you find some place, I want you to understand what leadership is about. Because if a leader is humble enough to understand that the weight of responsibility is on him, that's somebody that's worthy to submit to. Because they're not trying to have their way with you. And I have to say that because in the culture that we have, I don't want to cast like bad things on people, but I'll just be honest. Like leaders, Christian leaders, we have not done a great job.
Yeah.
As I talk to more and more people, and a lot of it comes from this. Mm-hmm. I can't expect you to just submit and obey because I'm just up here running my mouth. So, anyway, as we get into Jesus's assessment of this church, we have to understand that Jesus is sending a message to encourage and correct his church, and he's starting with the messengers. And as we get into this message, this idea of understanding leadership becomes more important because apparently that was what the church in Ephesus understood very well. So when we move down to Revelations 2:2-3, let's read. I know your deeds and your toil and perseverance, and that you cannot tolerate evil men. And you put to the test those who call themselves apostles, and they are not. And you found them to be false. And you have perseverance and have endured for my name's sake and have not grown weary. See, there's this theme in New Testament letters. And that is at the end times, the times which we're in now, that the body will be full of false teachers. The Ephesians had done the work of shepherds. They had been courageous to keep these wolves from devouring the flock, and we can't discount the work. And here's why. Because the New Testament talks more about protecting the flock from wolves than it does about teaching them. Like, this is a really big deal. And see, and here's why we have to point this out, because we have been seduced by a culture of inclusive, how you say it?
Inclusivity.
Look at y'all. Inclusivity, yeah, that. Here's why this is important, because that thinking, it convinces us that it's a bad idea to keep people out. We want people to feel so comfortable because we don't want them to think that we're judgy or legalistic or religious, but that philosophy of ministry is completely informed by the world and not by scripture. Because church functions as a place to keep people safe from the wolves. There's another thing why it's important to be called. Because this is important. This is why this is important. Because there are people who God would classify as wolves, and they are seeking to devour us. And none of us wants to be a bubbly Christian, right? I don't want to just be in a bubble, right? I get that. That sounds good. But from God's perspective, you're his children. And as a father, I'll tell you, Some of you guys I like a whole lot, but not everybody's watching my son. It's my job to protect him. And if somebody has to watch him, it's not going to be the guy in the corner in a Speedo just rubbing baby oil on himself. It's weird, right? Wait, but hold up. But wait. Listen. This, you know, it sounds crazy though, right? That sounds absolutely insane. But do you know that the Bible says that pride is likened unto witchcraft? And people have no discernment. That sounds absolutely insane what I just said. But somebody's full of pride and you allow them to sit in the pulpit. And you think that what they're saying is good. You think it's a good idea. We don't even know what a Christian looks like. And we just let anybody up here. Can I tell you, as somebody who has seen countless people fall, I've seen what nuts look like, and that's what it looks like. People preaching in the pulpit just with a Speedo on, rubbing lotion on them. You guys know that there was a guy who led a revival a few years ago? A lot of people got saved. He was real dope. People were really excited about him. You know what they found out? That he cheated on his wife, and he was doing the sermons drunk. Wow. So what are we talking about? We just let anybody in, right? You know what the church looks like? The guy in the corner rubbing the baby oil. You got to let him watch my son, because if not, he's going to think I'm judgy. Listen, the church is not a place to affirm your self-esteem.
Amen.
And I'm going to get into that a little bit later. But I'll tell you from the jump, not everybody here gets to teach. Not everybody here gets to sing. Not everybody here gets to lead. Because it's our job to equip people for the work of ministry, to make them strong that they can discern a wolf. But until they get there, it's our job to protect them. And I'd rather you think I'm legalistic than to be so welcoming that wolves think I'm a friend and not a shepherd. A wolf should see me and run, period. And y'all have seen him. That's the thing. Y'all have seen him come into church. Y'all have seen, here. Y'all have seen people come. There have been people who have come. And then we've had a meeting and they ain't come back. You know why? Because as a shepherd, I don't take kindly to wolves. And you shouldn't either. This was so important that this was the last thing that Paul told the leaders in the church of Ephesus. Go ahead to Acts. So he's leaving, and he sent to Ephesus, and he called all the elders of the church to him. And then 28, it says this: be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. Then he says this: I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. And from among your own selves, men will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. The trickiest part about wolves is that they come from inside of the church. Mm. Judas betrayed Jesus, not with a sword, but with a kiss.
Yep.
And I see them being made. Can I give you guys sorry, this is going to offend some of y'all.
That's okay.
When you get close to people's idols, you can see, they'll get offended. Let's talk about Kanye West for a second. But here's the thing. Here's what the church does. Can you imagine if think of your friend who is not a believer and who is in the world as much as possible. Imagine they get saved tomorrow. And then your answer is, okay, on Sunday, you go up there and you lead people. Would that be insane? The church is so thirsty and desperate for attention. It's what we're doing with him. You know how long it took Paul to become a leader in the church? 14 years. But we're so desperate to be cool. Like, y'all, there's nothing cool about what we do. Y'all know that, right? This whole thing is corny. Like, nobody's like, oh, man, you heard somebody preach from the Bible? Dang, like, that's corny. Y'all know that, right? I hope y'all know. I hope that's not your plan, is that you would be so cool and relatable to your friend that they would come to Christ. Y'all, we believe in a Jewish guy who died and was raised again. How is that relatable? But in our desire to be cool, we make ourselves easy prey for wolves. Bruh, when it comes, we're about to vote. I hope y'all aren't so foolish that all it takes is somebody to say, hey, I'm a Christian. Everybody's like, oh, I think he's a Christian. Yo, we don't even know what we're doing. Every single conservative politician has been a Christian. Up until this point, every single liberal politician has been a Christian. The ones who were against abortion, the ones who were for abortion. You know why? Because we're so susceptible to wolves. So, who's responsible? Wait, before I even say that, let me just give you a point in Revelations 2:6. He says this. He says, yet this do you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Now, this is up for debate. I'll tell you now. But Nicolaitans, some historians believe that the Nicolaitans actually come from a guy named Nicholas, who in Acts 6, he might have been one of the seven that was chosen to serve tables. You guys remember that? No, that's okay. You don't have to. So there was a time where there were so many people, they were all being served food, kind of like in this. And imagine that there were widows who were from a different place, who used to think differently, and they were getting served because everybody over here was judging them. So they took this to the apostles, and the apostles said, listen, we have to minister to the word. We can't be concerned with trying to serve tables. There's a work that we're called to. So what we're going to do is we're going to choose seven men full of the Spirit to lead. Stephen was one of them. Another guy named Nicholas was one. And some historians believe that it may be him. I think it may be. I won't tell you why. But here's the thing. The Nicolaitans, what they actually did, and listen to this, because they were believers who were Roman believers. And what happened was they began to mix their idol worship with Christian worship. So they were still doing worship that they were doing before, but they were trying to mix it and say, how can I, like, okay, I'm going to do this, but I'm going to Christianize it. I'll get into that later. I'm not saying nothing. I'll get into it. Well, and here's why. It's not because I'm trying to save you. I'm trying to save y'all time because there's going to be a letter that's going to really go in on the Nicolaitans. Okay. So, having said all that, who's responsible? In 2 Timothy 4:3, it says this. For the time will come that they will not endure sound doctrine, but wanting to have their ears tickled, they will accumulate for themselves teachers in accordance to their own desires. There is a burden on me as a leader to keep out wolves, but you can keep guard by yourself by not having itching ears. Let the scriptures be your guard. Endure sound doctrine and not teaching that's just going to agree with you, but not with the scriptures. The Ephesians, they crushed this. They kept these wolves out, but unfortunately, we're going to move to the next part. This wasn't the end of Jesus' assessment of them. In Revelation 2:4, it says this. But I have this against you. You have left your first love. You know, before we get to Revelation, as you're reading throughout all of the New Testament letters, every single church that is addressed in a letter, there's a rebuke. You need to do this. You need to fix this. This is not right. Ephesians is the only church that has no rebuke. It's just encouragement. Which gives you the ear that they are doing well. And Paul actually talks about it. They're doing well. They're doing a good job. He tells us in Ephesians 1:15, he says, for this reason, I too, having heard of the faith in the Lord Jesus, which exists among you and your love for all the saints. The first love of the church in Ephesus was their immense amount of faith in Christ. Amen. It was huge. And we're going to get to it in a second. But the church's faith was so great that it reached the ears of Paul. Somehow, between Ephesians and Revelation, which is written in 95 AD, they lost this. They lost this great faith for who Christ is. And I want to submit to you that this was a temptation for them. It was a temptation for the early church, and it will be a temptation for us. And this is where I want you guys to focus in. This portion here is what I believe you're here for. Because it's easy for us to live on the implications of our faith. First off, let's just even talk about that. Our faith in Christ. Something that some people would call the message of the gospel. Somebody just throw out what the gospel is. Louder. Say again. The word. Who else? John 3:16. What's John 3:16 say? Boom. Y'all hear that? It can get real deep. I'm going to give you a sermon on the gospel, but not right this moment. Here's what I'll say. Very simply. Jesus died for your sins. There's implications that come from that get complicated, but put blank simply, that Jesus died for your sins. And here's the thing. Here's where we can fall off as a church. We can get lost in the implications of the gospel without really building a solid foundation of the imperatives of the gospel. Here's what I mean. An implication is a truth. If there's a truth, there's something that it implies. For example, does God love you? Does he love everyone?
Yes.
What if they're not a believer?
Yes.
Okay. So that's an implication. But one thing that we learn in scripture is that God is love. Everybody agree with that, right?
Yes.
God is love. But here's how we know the love of God, that he sent his son to die on the cross. Amen. So we can preach an implication, but if we don't have the imperative that God's love shows himself in Christ dying, we'll miss a whole foundation. And you have people living whatever life they want, doing whatever they want, not having any desire for God, not wanting to submit their life to him at all. And they come in here and hear that God loves them and they leave and think it's okay. Because they heard an implication.
Amen.
Let me give you just some imperatives of the gospel. An imperative of the gospel. So if God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, why did he have to do it? Because the world is in sin. That's right. Jesus says, I didn't come to condemn the world. It's condemned already. And if you don't get to that imperative, everything else is just fluff. I can pat you on the back all day long, but if I pat you on the back on the way to hell, does it really matter? See, this isn't an encouragement to be excited and to be on fire with your love for Christ. No, no, no. When he says you've lost your first love, the Greek actually means your chief, your love. It means first among everything. Jesus is not saying be super excited about the gospel. Jesus is saying make it first. That is who we should be known for. That is what we stand in, is the gospel. And Paul does this all the time in 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 4. He says this when he comes and he's talking about he came to plant the church there, right? In Corinthians, he says, for I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received. What did he receive? That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried and that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Then again, in 1 Corinthians 2, 1 through 2, he says this. When I came to you, brethren, I did not come with superiority of speech or of wisdom proclaiming to you the testimony of God. I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ. Like, understand, he's saying I could have came with wisdom. I know this thing better than all of you. But I didn't. I came to you with Jesus. Y'all. This, and I almost thought about putting a clip up there, but I don't want to cause divisiveness or not. But listen, I don't know if you guys follow any preachers, whether it be YouTube, whether it be IG, but I would encourage you to follow your top preachers and go and listen to their little sermon snippet that's got the cool words going and the music coming in the back, and ask yourselves, from that, can I tell that that is about Christ or is that just wisdom? Because if I come up here and I say, listen, guys, I want you to know that you have had a hard life, but God has not missed your circumstance. He has seen it. But I want you to know that your setback is a setup for a comeback. Hey, can I get an amen? That's fantastic. And you'll have great words of wisdom for you to live your life, and you may spend your eternal life in hell. And I'm saying this because I have been it. I have done it. I spent years doing evangelism. And we used to do this thing. We used to call it onion evangelism, right? It was this idea that onions have a lot of layers, right? And in the middle is people's need for God and need for their salvation. But on there's all these layers on the outside. And if people don't like their relationship, and if you don't speak to their the relationship that they have with their boyfriend, they'll never get to the core. That sounds great. That sounds wise. But the reality is, that doesn't make me any different than a Buddhist. There's nothing imperatively Christian about that. Amen. So, Jesus gives them counsel. In Revelations 2:5, he says, therefore, remember from where you have fallen and repent and do the deeds you did at first, or else I'm coming to you. Yo, that first off, if Jesus gives you a or else, like, bruh, or else, y'all were bad kids. I was a good kid. So I'll tell you now, when my mom said or else, I was terrified. Sorry. Everybody's so traumatic. Some of y'all like, I just like trigger something for you. You're not a bad kid. I'm sorry. Again, notice that the command of Jesus, look, he doesn't counsel them. You've lost your first love, so I need you to get back excited about me. That's not what he does. It's to repent. And these are people who are already believers. And he says, you've lost your first love, so therefore, repent. You guys remember what repent means? We went over it before. Let's see if y'all were listening. What does repent mean? Change your way of thinking. It actually means, it's actually two Greek words together. It means to change direction after being with. It literally means you've met Jesus, and after being with him, you will change direction. He says to repent and then change your deeds. Can I just be honest with you guys? Like, because like in church, we tend to go from one extreme to the other. Right. And so because there's been so much like legalistic, super authoritative control from churches, we have swung to the other way of like super grace. Right. So for me to be to tell you, or even God to tell you to do something, seems legalistic. Jesus doesn't care about that, though. He told them, repent and change your deeds. He doesn't say go to an all night worship thing and get really excited about it. Nothing wrong with all night worship things. But who cares how much you worship if you refuse to change your thinking and your deeds?
Amen.
You can't excite your way back into a love for the gospel. There's only one way. That's repent. Jesus said, didn't come and say, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Hurry up and get in. He says, repent. The kingdom of heaven is at hand. And these people did. They repented and they came into the kingdom. They lost their first love. And Jesus' response to them is repent. It's what gets you in, keeps you in. Repent. We have to remove this negative view of repentance. If you've lost the gospel as your first and chief love, or if the gospel has never been that to you, start with repentance.
Amen.
And how you're thinking and in what you're doing.
Amen.
Look, he's saying this to the Ephesians. Go to the next one. This is what they did when they heard this gospel. Listen, this is the Ephesian church. Many also of those who had believed kept coming, talking to hear from Paul, well, to the other leaders, confessing and disclosing their practices. So wait, pause. They heard the word and they said, this is what I've been doing. This is how my life, they immediately wanted to confess. And then it says, and many of those who practiced magic brought their books together and began burning them in the sight of everyone. And they counted up the price of them and found it to be 50,000 pieces of silver. You know how much that would be worth today? $5.5 million.
Wow.
That's a lot of books. Yo, but look, we live in this really corny place as believers. It's like you can become a believer and it really not affect anything in your life.
Mm.
That doesn't fit. Let me say this, and I want to be clear about this because I want you guys to hear this. If you come here and you amen on Sunday and you love worshiping and you love coming to prayer meetings, but you don't have any of this in your life, you should check the roots.
Amen.
Jesus called 12. One of them betrayed him. The other 11 were murdered for their faith. This Christian thing is not a power grab. The gospel of Christ brings this about. These people weren't required. That's the thing. That's what's so crazy about this. This isn't required. The requirement of the gospel is that you repent, but that you would confess with your mouth and believe in your heart.
Amen.
Boom.
Boom.
This isn't required.
It's the fruit.
It's the fruit. Because their actions pointed to something else that was happening inside of them. I don't want to create legalistic people that go around and think that the more devoted things that they do, the more they'll have of Christ. I don't want to like do that, but I also want to be real. I want to. Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven is a treasure. He says it's like a treasure that a man hides in a or man finds in a field. In his joy, he sells everything that he has just to buy the field.
Amen.
Doesn't that look like that?
Yes.
Forget this church for a second, all right? Because I don't want y'all to think I'm trying to like control you. This is like, forget this. This is one of the reasons why I never want to be a pastor. Because I would have said this 10 years ago. Forget this church for a second. Isn't it crazy that the Bible puts this up as believers and we try and get people to come to prayer? Well, you know, I really had a really rough day. The New Testament church, it says that they were together all the time. We've been talking about giving a lot, right? And we've been having this debate. I won't get into it, but we've been having this debate on is tithing for today or not right? You can disagree or agree with that, whatever. But here's what I know: the New Testament church, they gave everything. They sold houses. They sold land. Not out of some like weird thinking that this was going to get them justified, but because it's just what came out. You can't stop having sex with your boyfriend or girlfriend. And hear me. It's not because there's anything inherently evil about you. It's because I'm hoping it's because maybe you've never seen this.
No.
Maybe you've never seen that to make a decision for Christ absolutely interrupts your life. Listen, if you're not a believer, this is what I want to tell you. Jesus is not waiting for you to allow him in your heart. He doesn't want your heart. It's not in what you gave. He don't want that. If you think that, we'll give it back to you. He wants your life. So you better count the cost. You know why? You know why this happens? Because repentance is what love looks like. Repentance is a changing of thinking. Anybody ever been, people you know. You know anybody who ever got into a relationship and now they're married, but one of the spouses refuses to repent and think like a married person? Hey, listen, I'll tell you now. I haven't been married a long time. I've only been married 8 years, but the one thing I know, the number one thing in marriage is repentance. Because as long as I've been married, there has been this struggle to continue to think like I'm single. You know, when I first came home, the first day we moved, this is ridiculous. This is the caliber of leader y'all have right now. We got married.
This is 8 years ago.
I went to work. No, Sunday night, we went to the grocery store. We got groceries. I went to work. I came back home. I looked in the refrigerator and I said, I'm like furious. I've been working 12 hours. Where is the food at? She said, we ate it. I was like, oh snap. They're going to eat too. When you love people, biblically, a marriage is actually a joining of two people into one. It's a union. So when you marry someone, if you continue to think on your own, have actions on your own, if your heart is still by itself and not fused with the other person, it's going to affect your marriage. You are also in union with Christ. You want to know, sorry to be offensive, you want to know the one of the bigger analogies that God makes of the people of Israel in the Old Testament? An adulteress. You know why? Because they refuse to change their thinking to one of being a single nation to one that's married to God. So let me ask you this. Would you say that your faith in Christ is chief love of your life? Like really, if you up until this point, if you've been hearing this sermon and you're like, man, that's good stuff. That's good stuff. And you're thinking about other people. Pause. Think about yourself. I don't care how long you've been in the church. I don't care how much Bible you know. Would you say that your love for Christ, your faith in Christ, is chief in your heart? If not, what is? And are you fine to keep it that way? If not, what do you need to burn? What do you need to sell? You know what's dope about the church? The church allows like repentance in a safe space. Anybody in here, since you've been at this church, you've had to repent of something and people have helped you through it. Me. The dope thing about repentance is there were people there who probably didn't want to burn their books, but they were convicted that they should. But there were people to the left and right of them that were doing it and that could encourage them that this is the right thing to do. It's the beauty of the church. Let me give you the or else. And then I'm done. I'm gonna end on the bad note. Revelations 2:5. You can say it, keep it there. Go to 2:5. Sorry. No, back to 2:5. You gotta go back. He says, or else I am coming to you and I'll remove your lampstand out of its place unless you repent. Jesus tells them, again, very quickly, the church is given the symbol of a lampstand because the church mirrors the Holy Spirit. And the church mirrors the Holy Spirit who is given the symbol of a lampstand because in the holy place, the Holy Spirit or the menorah, the lampstand, was the only thing that gave light to the holy place. Outside of the lampstand, there was no light. That's why you get these pictures of the church being the light of the world, all that stuff, right? And in the holy place, there was the table of showbread, which is supposed to be his presence. I won't get into it. But the church is in jeopardy here. Jesus is literally saying, if you don't get this in order, I will remove the church. Like, Jesus is not tripping on the fellowship. Like, he can't, he loves us. He wants us to be here. But the first and foremost thing is that we will be a church, a lampstand. And there is no church without the gospel. This is what Jesus told Peter. We read about it last week. He says, on this rock, the rock of the gospel of who Jesus is, I will build my church. This is Jesus's church, and it will be built on his foundation, or it will no longer be a church. A church that doesn't have the gospel as its chief love is no church at all. This is why Jesus warns that if you don't return to your first love, I'll remove the lampstand. Because the whole purpose of the lampstand is to shine light on the bread of life. That's what we're here for. So let me tell you, loving your neighbor is needed. But if a church is built on loving their neighbor and not the gospel, that's not a church. You know what that is? That's Mormonism, because they kill us in this. Anybody ever met a Mormon? Nicest people in the world. They got love your neighbor down. You know what they don't have? Gospel. Anointed teaching is needed. But if a church is built on the teacher, on the anointing of the teacher, it's not a church. The prophetic, signs and wonders, whatever. If we are known for anything else, at best, we're a social club. And we do good deeds in the community, but it does not make us a church. The foundation of our community is not love for each other. Can I say that? This is, and when we get into the church later, The foundation of our community is not the love that we have for each other, but it's our love that we have for God. Because we have one thing in common, that while we are in sin, Christ died at the right time so that we would know him. That's what we have in common. That's what we're built on. And that is the only hope for the world. You guys understand, like, sorry, Revelation 2:7. This is why the Spirit says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the church. To him who overcomes, I will grant to eat the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. That word overcomes is actually over to he who is overcoming. He says he'll grant to eat from the tree of life. You know why he says that? Because the gospel is the only means to life. I'll end with a story. So I preached this one time at a Christian school. It was in Peachy County. That's going to be important in a set. So I preached this sermon. And the sermon was about, I think it was like offense or something. What's my Jeremiah sermon about? You remember? It was like offense or something. I can't remember. essentially, bad things happen in your life. Where is God? All that.
Yeah.
I preached this sermon. I have never seen this in my entire 14 years of preaching. I preached this sermon and people were bawling. Like every single person. I looked at the leaders and the leaders were looking at me with this terrified look because they had never seen their students act like this. Like they were laying on the ground, scream crying. Oh, wow. This is like if you guys don't know this, I don't know y'all's background, but like a young black dude is the epitome of coolness. Just so you know. Everything, I'll just be honest. So when you're at that age, I'm in PG County, it's high school kids. I mean, I don't know, somewhere. I want to say Oxon Hill, maybe, like far, it was deep.
Okay.
So, they're coming, they have on everything as, like, they're super fresh, like, do-rags super tight, they got their fitted. By the time I got done preaching, they were sprawled out. They were snotting, like snotting on their clothes. I'm serious, like it was do-rags just laying out. Like. But listen, look. It was literally the most insane thing that I've ever seen. And I could, like, it was nuts.
That's so cool.
But I was there to preach twice. My first sermon was, despite what you've gone on, what you've had go on in your life, God sees you.
Yeah.
He's with you. He loves you. You can trust in who God says he is. You know what was missing from my first sermon? Christ.
Okay.
There was no drawback to the gospel at all. It was a sermon like I just told y'all about. Mm-hmm. My second sermon came and I scrapped it and I said, I have to preach to you guys something that's important. Because I just told you all that God is for you. He's with you. He hasn't left your situation. That God is still intimately with you. But the truth of the matter is, if you haven't repented and believed in Christ, the Bible would say that there is something in between you and him. The Bible would say that unless you come through Christ, you cannot know him. Because Jesus says, I am the way. I am the truth. No one goes to the Father except for me. And I'm sorry, but I just told you guys that you all had a relationship with God that it's impossible to have unless you turn to Christ.
Yeah.
You know how many do-rags were sprawled out on the floor? Zero.
Yeah.
I could build a career off the first sermon. The Christ thing, that's what gets people sucking their teeth while I'm preaching. How do you go from scream crying to sucking your teeth while I'm preaching? You know why? Paul says, I'm unashamed of the gospel. Anybody know the rest of that? Anybody know what Paul says that the gospel is to people who don't believe? Foolishness. We're building a church on foolishness. And you know why? Because it offends men. And here's the truth of the matter. And this is the last thing I want to say to you guys. If you're here and you are a believer, and the gospel is not the chief of your loves, I will say this to you. Repent. Be careful. Because if you've never had quality relationships, you can come into a church and get quality relationships. It does not make you a Christian. If you need something to make you feel righteous, you can read your Bible enough to make you feel righteous, but it does not mean you have a relationship with God. So repent. Change the way that you're thinking. Change your deeds. Ask yourself, look in your life and say, do I have books that need to be burned? Do I have relationships that need to be burned? Do I have ways of thinking that completely don't fit in Scripture? And if you're somebody here and you would say, I'm definitely not a believer. Let me just ask you this. As you go on, you know that the Bible says this. It says, is it appointed for every man to die once, and then comes judgment. Know that when you die and you open your eyes, you are going to be face to face with the person who has given you breath your entire life. And the question he's going to have for you is, why should I let you in? And if you think it's based on what you do, you have a problem there. Because the Bible demands perfection. And not just in what you do, but what you think, what you feel. You know, Jesus says, he says, you've heard that you should not commit adultery. But he says, I say to you that if you've looked at another person with lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. Yeah. And if Jesus is putting adulterers in hell and you've lusted after someone, you don't have to come back here at all, but somebody should tell you straight. There is no means of salvation outside of Christ. Yep. And instead of just hearing that and saying, well, they would say that at a different church, that every belief has their own. Forget all that for a second and ask yourself, if it's not true, explain to yourself why not, using the words that he's put in his Bible. Dig. Doesn't matter. Christianity, I heard C.S. Lewis say, Christianity is the only thing that if it's incorrect, it means of nothing. It means nothing. But if it's right, it means everything. Yep.